In the Warsaw Ghetto, there was a symphony orchestra, a small orchestra, vocal ensembles, children's choir. The Vilna Ghetto had a symphony orchestra, chamber groups, Yiddish and Hebrew choirs, theaters, music schools. In the Lutz Ghetto, there was a theater, symphony orchestra, choral society, string singers, cabaret, youth group singing, etc., so forth. Theresienstadt was set up by the Nazis as a model concentration camp where they sent the top intellectual Jews in the society, the top musicians, philosophers, scientists, lecturers. They sent them to Theresienstadt because they wanted to use it as a model ghetto to show the world how great they were being to the Jews. So, because of this, and also because eventually a vast amount of music making was allowed to happen, Theresienstadt had the most music making. They had orchestras, chamber groups, solo recitals, jazz ensembles, choirs, music theater groups, etc. After the first transport of prisoners to Theresienstadt, there was informal folk singing in the men's barrack. 2 days after the second transport, there was the first informal secret concert held again in the basement, where they had an eclectic mix of poetry reading, flute, accordion, and a few other instruments. At first they didn't have a piano, so they used other things like accordion or pitch pipe to accompany the other instruments. And then they found a piano. And it was a broken piano. It had no legs and it wouldn't stay in tune. But they were able to use it. They propped it up on boxes instead of legs. And they had a piano tuner come in between movements to tune it so that they could actually use it for performances. And they were thrilled. That was very exciting for them to be able to have a piano. Later, the Nazis found out about these secret performances, and instead of banning them as might be expected, they created the Freie Gestaltung, which was an organization to govern cultural activities in the ghetto. This led to even more performances, because not only was it now allowed and eventually insisted upon that they perform for certain occasions, but they also had better access to certain instruments and some degree of music and sheet paper to compose. In the height of performances, popular concerts such as Smetana's opera, The Bartered Bride, was performed 35 times. There were often 7 concerts in one evening that you could choose which one you wanted to attend. Critical reviews were written about the concerts by Ullmann and others. And they had concert series of youth music, new music, and more. For popular performances, where someone couldn't obtain a ticket, they would climb through the window to try to hear and find a space to stand in the back. So why did they do this? Why did they work so hard? What made it so important to them? First of all, it did help them physically. Lives were spared. In Theresienstadt, the Jewish council was in charge of creating lists for the Nazis of which Jews were going to be transported to Auschwitz and mostly gassed, although they didn't know that at the time. Pianist Edith Kraus had her name on one of these lists, and they were informed a few days before. So at the suggestion of her friends, she gave a piano recital. After her successful concert, her name was removed from the list. So it saved her life. In addition, in Auschwitz, in the Women's Orchestra, an accordion member once burned her hand, and she was unable to play for a period of time. And about this, an SS member told her, "It's lucky for you that you're our accordion player, otherwise we would send you to the gas today." Also, food prizes were given, cigarettes, better living conditions, slightly better food. For instance, in Theresienstadt, there was a competition, or a bet, rather, of whether this quartet could play a Mozart string quartet entirely by memory. And the prize was a can of liver patty. They won the prize, they did it. However, it wasn't just for physical survival, or even primarily for physical survival. An indication of this is that they performed concerts in secret, even at great risk to their own lives. In Theresienstadt, once performances were allowed, they still held secret concerts with anti-Nazi music, such as Taub's Theresienstadt Symphony, This symphony, the second movement, is a lullaby to a Jewish child, where the mother sings of her disappointment at not being able to give a proper home. And the third and final movement has Deutschland über alles, which was the German national part of the German national anthem, and it's repeated again and again, Germany above all, until it dies away in friction. So this was seen as an anti-Nazi message, and it was given in secret because of that. In addition, in Auschwitz, the Women's Orchestra, which was created by the Nazis for their purposes, they still programmed some music that was not allowed. They were not allowed to play music by Jewish composers, and despite this, they played Mendelssohn's Violin Concerto as an act of resistance. So what made it so important for them that they worked so hard to perform all this music, that it kept them alive emotionally? They used it to distract from reality, to hope for their future, and for moralization. Willy Mahler wrote in Theresienstadt, "The mere fact that artists and scientists continue to work encourages others. They connect like a chain the reality of yesterday with that of today and the future. This spiritual chain is the meaning of life, that is humanity." So if Jews here in Theresien, in spite of their circumstances, set an example to create other permanently valuable sections of this chain, they have served mankind and have proven worthy of passing this test of humanity and of being and of living on. So it really gave them the reason to exist, to see some semblance of purpose in their lives. Another Theresien prisoner recalled, "The loss of human dignity could much more easily break the prisoner than starvation, forced labor, and maltreatment." Music also served to commiserate with each other. In the Women's Orchestra, a member recalled, "It was a link with the outside, with beauty, with culture, a complete escape into an imaginary and unattainable world. We lifted ourselves above the inferno of Birkenau into a sphere where we could not be touched by the degradation of concentration camp existence. On such an occasion, there was great closeness among us all." Music was also often used as resistance. In Theresienstadt, the Nazis ordered a propaganda film to be created titled "Hitler Gives a Town to the Jews," along with a visit from the Red Cross to prove how well they were being cared for. So in order to prepare for this visit, first, they had to take care of the problem of overcrowding. They did this by sending a huge portion of the population to Auschwitz to be gassed. They had other problems. They had to set up a fake bank where they printed ghetto money that was completely useless. They also set up a pretend post office where they made pretty wrappings around some empty boxes to pretend they were presents. They set up a children's playground and some other problems. They also used music as a huge part of the propaganda. The Jews didn't have shoes on stage, so they solved this problem by putting flower pots at the edge of the stage to cover their feet. They did let the Jews select some of the repertoire for the propaganda film, and they chose a children's opera, Burundibar. Burundibar, the plot of this is that there's two children who need money for their mother to buy her milk because she's sick. So they try to go to the town to bus, but there's an evil organ grinder named Rundibar. This evil organ grinder had a Hitler mustache and was clearly made to represent Hitler. He tried to prevent them from getting money to save their mother's life. In the end, with some help from some forest friends, the children succeed in getting the money and buying milk for their mother. And this was a clear anti-Nazi message, and all the children and everyone knew what it was about. In addition, they programmed Verdi's Requiem. And they saw this as an anti-Nazi message. They saw it as a requiem for the fallen. Murray Sidlin, who was there, recalled, "Through Edgar Krasa, I learned that the requiem was a code. It talks about the end of the world and what happens to those who commit evil. Even as they were facing their own destruction, the Jews in that choir were telling the Nazis how the Third Reich was doomed." Music helped also create an identity taken into Auschwitz, and as with every other prisoner, she was stripped of everything that identified her. Her possessions were taken, her clothing, her hair shaven off, her name taken and a number tattooed on her arm, everything that made her who she was. And then she was recruited to the Women's Orchestra. She recalled, "I may no longer have had a name, but I was identifiable. I could be referred to, I was the cellist." So for the prisoners, it created an illusion of normalcy. The very fact that they had critical reviews written in a concentration camp was extremely unusual. Pianist Alice Summers Hertz gave a Chopin recital, and the review on this was especially interesting. The unknown critic wrote, "On behalf of mankind, I lament here and deplore the early young life of a master, Chopin, prematurely snatched away from the world." Now, he doesn't mention that the pianist herself, Alice, was a young master prematurely snatched from the world. A singer in Theresienstadt, Otto Abelis, wrote in a letter to his loved one about how glowing and wonderful things were there with all of the performances. And he wrote, "How much lovelier it would be if I could see you listening to my singing and sharing with me the delight in these divine strains." Wait a second, the only thing he's upset about is that she's not in the concentration camp with him? So it wasn't that. It was that he was trying to live in a delusional society where because he couldn't face the reality. Simon Lax, who eventually went on to conduct the orchestra in Auschwitz, the men's orchestra, recalled when he was first taken into Auschwitz and experiencing all the shock and horrors, he heard an orchestra playing. And he recalled, "I was appalled by the terrible playing out of tune of some of the wind instruments." Now, normally, I understand being appalled by out of tune wind instruments, but when experiencing all of these things, it seems unusual that that would be what he wrote and recalled as appalling. And it was because he couldn't bear to face the reality of what was appalling, so he placed it on the wind instruments. Music was so important to this culture that thousands of inmates would stand in the barracks in Auschwitz, back of the barracks, waiting hours outside to hear prisoner orchestras perform. Psychologist Viktor Frankl, who survived Auschwitz, wrote about some cabaret performances that he heard in Auschwitz. And he wrote, "The gatherings were so effective that a few ordinary prisoners went to see the cabaret in spite of the fatigue, even though they missed their daily portion of food by dying." So these are people that are starving, do not have enough food to get through, and they're probably going to die of starvation, and yet they missed their once daily portion of food to hear a cabaret performance. That's the level of commitment. The Hasidic dances I'm going to play next were premiered in Victor Ullmann's second concert series in Theresienstadt, titled Young Composers in Theresien. Schul's music was highly programmatic, often for violas. He was a violist himself. And you think Hasidic dances, it's a distraction, but it's not just a distraction. It also speaks directly to the situation at hand. He used largely Jewish themes. Before the war, he studied liturgical music, and he saw that as the future of composition to go to turn to folk music. And his songs in Theresienstadt typically had biblical lyrics, hoping for a future in Israel. For example, "The wasteland will be worked and will no longer be desert." Or, "Sound the great shofar for our freedom and shield to our fathers." All of these indicate a hope for the future. So again, now here's my own artistic interpretation. The first movement begins as a Hasidic dance. It's a happy illusion of distraction, but it gives away a few of the circumstances. For example, at the end of the first movement, the dance dies away to pianissimo, but then a gunshot for an awakening. The second movement, the second dance, begins with an incessant marching in the cello, and it's beyond a dance. It's almost a plotting of fate. The viola on top has the dance melody, but in strange rhythmic contrast to the cello part. The viola is in 3/8, while the cello is in 4/8. So this, to me, is the juxtaposition of the Jewish dance music in a concentration camp. The rhythmic contrast